Welcome to Homeschool University, where life meets learning. Hey, today we're talking about homeschool co-ops, things like choosing a structure for a new co-op, or how about how to find families to join your co-op. Then there's everybody's favorite, the planning and paperwork side. Yep, and we're gonna finish out with how to keep an existing co-op going strong. So I'm actually splitting this topic into two videos. Yep, trying to keep information in a little shorter format so it's not quite so overwhelming. In this video, part one, we'll get into the initial steps, you know, thinking about homeschool co-ops in general. And then in part two, I'm actually gonna give you all the specifics you need to get your meetings up and running. So, homeschool co-ops are a hot topic right now because a lot of you out there are new to school at home, and banding together with a bunch of other families, yeah, sounds like a super good idea. The old pool your resources, or maybe divide and conquer, and you know, all that sort of thing. That's what comes to mind when you think about sharing your homeschool journey with others. This is all good stuff. Hey, and speaking of sharing good stuff, if this video is helpful to you, oh, please hit that little like button, you know, this one, the thumbs up, and share this video with all of your homeschooling friends. This is how you let YouTube know that what I'm doing here is valuable. And then the mighty algorithm. Oh yes, we'll get my videos in front of a lot more eyeballs. So let's cut through the co-op myths and mysteries and get you on the right track. I recently came across a blog post that really surprised me. It was simple enough, 7 ways to start a homeschool co-op you and your kids will love, written by someone who I do not know, named Deanna Wood. Now, I've started and run several co-ops in my homeschool career, plus I've been part of several more, and I think I'm pretty up to date on the whole co-op thing. But that said, I am always on the lookout to fine-tune what I personally know so I can bring you all the very best content. But as I started digging through this blog post, I realized the author and I were not on the same page. Ooh, possibly not in the same universe. Yes. This is her description of the co-op that she started and is currently leading. Right here, this is a quote. Our co-op meets 4 days a week from 8 to 3:30. We teach all subjects, and parents can either pay full price for teaching services or they can swap services by volunteering. Some parents do a combination of both. Okay, did you catch that? This co-op meets 4 days a week from 8 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. and parents have the option of either participating or just paying money to have someone else giving their kids what they need. Now, let's hold on a minute here. Seriously, I'm sorry, but this is not a co-op. This is a private school that's flying under the radar of government regulation and oversight. Yeah, a homeschool co-op should be an extracurricular activity, not a replacement for your homeschool. This is not, mind you, a condemnation of what this author is part of. I mean, if you want to join a school like this, well, by all means do. But if you're looking to augment rather than replace your homeschool program, I suggest you think of a co-op as like a dessert item, you know, something that you do with other families just for the fun of it. Like subjects that are more fun in a group setting, or maybe a topic that would benefit from pooled resources. In just a minute, I'm going to give you some really specific ideas about the framework that you might use to actually get your co-op going. But let's just be clear about what a successful co-op looks like. It does not look like a school. It does not separate you from your kids for an entire day. But it is a shared experience designed to promote those valuable social interactions. So now, let's put some meat on these bones. So now we're gonna dive into my top five proven homeschool co-op formats that work with any size group, any age spread, and are guaranteed to bring you those social benefits that will spice up the learning aspect of your co-op. By the way, all of these, I'm gonna assume they would meet for 2 to 4 hours, usually one day a week, but it could be on a weekly or even a bi-monthly basis. So number one on this list would be a field trips co-op. Yep, you can start a co-op that just meets for field trips. Now, there are some great benefits to this one. First, group discounts are a thing, yeah. What might be cost prohibitive to visit with your family, just you alone, becomes affordable when you can sign up as a group. And second, what better way to informally hang out with other homeschoolers while still checking off the school box? Yeah, talk about a win-win. So now we're gonna go to number two here on our list, which would be a co-op geared to a specific topic. How about a math games co-op? Yes, we were in one. It was great fun, nothing but math-based games. Yep. How about a history reenactment co-op or just science experiments? All of these topics are a lot more fun with a group, and pooled resources can help provide the stuff that you might not otherwise have access to, like the good science equipment, right? Or historical costumes. Parents, in this one, take turns leading, with those not actively teaching, pitching in to help the kids keep things rolling along. So the next one we have here would be art, gym, and music. This one is a rotation-based format, entirely focused on the three subjects that, be honest here, A, you probably skip in your homeschool, and B, work much better in a group. The kids rotate between, yep, art, gym, and music class every time you meet. As in the last example, parents can take turns leading while everyone else is helping for 2 of the hours that you're meeting, right? And then using the remaining hour for something really cool, which would be mom chat time. Sign me up. Yes. If you've got a small group, you'd want to keep all the kids together for the three subjects. However, in a large group, maybe you've got 20 or more families, you're probably going to want to group the kids according to what I call age stage, which is simply saying, okay, younger, middle, older. This is mostly to facilitate gym time, because gym games are a lot easier to choose and put into practice when you've got kids that are approximately the same size and about the same skill level. Just saying. Now, I do want to throw out there is a variation of this, and that would be to run art, gym, and music on separate class meetings. So in other words, week one is art, week two is gym, week three is music, week four is art, week five is gym, and so on. You get the drift. I happen to really like running all three during the same meeting time. But the reason that I like that is because it gave the kids such a big break from the regular routine of homeschool. So I'm just saying, I used both. You could use either one. So let's go on now to our next one, which would be a unit studies co-op. Here, parents take turns teaching a short unit of a specific topic. So if your co-op meets weekly, a topic could last for a month. That's 4 classes total. Topics are brainstormed by the group and are usually based on skills that parents can bring to the table. So let me give you some examples. If you've got mad art skills, you could volunteer to teach a unit on drawing faces. If science is your deal, how about a unit on identifying trees? Lots of field trip possibilities in that one. How about history? Maybe a unit on Egypt. We did one years ago, complete with salt maps, cartouche necklaces, and a museum trip to see actual mummies. The kids loved it. By the way, this format is really great for large groups because you can add in aspects to challenge the older kids while still keeping it real for the littler guys, right? This brings us to our last format, which would be a community service co-op. This format requires a bit more advanced planning and creativity because you're dealing with the needs of an outside group. Basically, the title says it all, right? You're taking your kids out into the world to serve others. So when our family was part of a group like this, we were going to nursing homes to help with special events and outings because they need people to do things like push wheelchairs. Yeah. Lots of studies, here's a big tip bonus on this one, lots of studies have actually shown that kids who volunteer with their parents are much more likely to volunteer as adults. Yeah, that is a big plus. And another plus here would be having a group to find volunteer opportunities with. That is a whole lot less intimidating than trying to do this sort of thing on your own. Just say. Okay, so now you have a framework for your co-op and you're ready to find families to join the fun that will turn your good ideas into a real, honest-to-goodness, functioning co-op. Now, sometimes it's really easy to get the word out, especially if you attend a church where there are other homeschoolers, or maybe you belong to a homeschool support group already. But even if you don't have a ready resource for co-opers, you can still recruit. Yes, tell you what, every state has a state homeschool organization. You can just internet search for state homeschool organization. Very easy. Now, many of these groups are going to help you because they have an online bulletin board where you can actually post a notice about your co-op. They might even have a contact person, somebody associated with a state level organization, but that lives in your area. And this person would be very likely to have lots of connections with local homeschoolers. So even if, you know, none of this is available to you or it doesn't work, tell you what, you can still connect with other families simply by keeping your eyes open. Let's face it, if a family's at a local museum in the middle of the day, or even the grocery store, odds are you've got homeschooling in common. So strike up a conversation and let word of mouth advertising do its thing. Hey, print off some little cards that just give a little information like the name and a phone number where they can reach you, and let it multiply. This step does not have to be intimidating. Tell you what, five families are plenty big enough to start a great co-op. The point here is to get the ball rolling and let the fun begin. So let's see, you've got great ideas and a few families to join in the fun. Sounds like you're ready to dive into the homeschool co-op pool. So in my next video, we are going to flesh out all the lovely details, the paperwork and planning and all that swell stuff, as well as ideas on how to keep a co-op going strong. But for now, I have got a simple assignment for you, and it is this. Get excited! Yes! You know what? Notch up your enthusiasm for what is going to be one of the best parts of homeschooling for you and your kids, and you will have a co-op experience that just overflows with awesomeness. So, until next time, teach like your hair's on fire, but in a practical, purposeful, positive way. Yep, you can do this, homeschool mom, because you are amazing.
Hey now, take a step outside and seize the day.